This one's for And to kick things off, I'm going to turn the mic over to Representative Gail Haynes, who was the sponsor of one of these great bills.
Thank you very much, Governor Snyder, for having me here today. And thank you to all of the veterans for your service, and also to today's sponsors for making this possible. The legislation that is being signed today will allow a military healthcare specialist to use the education and experience that he or she obtained through military service toward a civilian emergency medical technician license. This is one of the many bills that my colleagues and I have been working on to make sure that veterans are fully recognized for their service to our country. Upon return, veterans should not have to repeat education to qualify for jobs that they have already been highly trained for. We will continue here in Michigan to break down employment barriers and assure that these talented individuals are welcome in Michigan. And our goal is to make Michigan the veteran-friendly state. So again, thank you, Governor, for your support, and thank you again to the military men and women who are here with us today. And at this point, I'd like to introduce my colleague, State Representative George Durrini.
Thank you. Thank you, Gail. It's an absolute honor for me to be here today with the Governor today to sign this legislation into law. I was pleased to sponsor House Bill number 4754, which allows veterans to use their military experience in heating, cooling, and refrigeration when furthering their careers after service. But today is a little bit more personal for me. You see, today is my first bill signed into law. So, thank you. And I'm also the son of an Army veteran who served during World War II. Now, I never took the opportunity to thank my dad for his service and his sacrifice. He's been gone for years, but I know he's with me today as I hold his good conduct medal in my hand. So I thank him with this bill, and I know he would be proud that my first law will help veterans. He is proud also today that we are sending a clear message that the people of Michigan are truly grateful for their service. And I'm pleased to have an outstanding veteran with me here today. As a U.S. Army veteran, Gary Tanner works tirelessly to help provide the best possible care for Michigan veterans and their families. His dedication has certainly improved the quality of life for veterans across the state. Thank you, Gary. So it's been an honor today to be a part of this celebration of signing of these bills, bills that will help support the brave men and women of our state. So I thank you, and I thank you, Governor, for the opportunity to thank my dad.
Thank you.
Thank you, George. Good morning, everyone. How's everybody doing today? My name is Bob Kozlowski, and it is my honor to be here today. You know, similar to George, my family has a deep history in the military. In fact, my grandfather was killed in World War II on a ship. So this really means a lot to me. I would like to thank several people. First off, I'd like to thank the Boilermakers 1609, the local, for helping me research a lot of this bill. You know, and I also like to thank the governor. I think the governor's vision for this is awesome. He's always on the forefront of working with veterans, and I applaud him for that. You know, our committee, we're all on the Military and Veteran Committee. Jim Stamos is our chair. I can tell you, when there's a red light and a green light, how we vote, it is always a green light for veterans, and I applaud that. You know, I like to quote the 26th President of the United States, who argued that no other group of citizens deserve greater honor, respect, and gratitude than the nation's veterans. President Theodore Roosevelt once said, "A man who's good enough to shed his blood for his country is good enough to be given a square deal afterwards." You know, I like to take that one step further. I think it should be more than a square deal, and I think with the governor's lead, we're on our way. Thank you, and God bless.
Well, thank you for those wonderful talents. Let's sign the bill. Thank you. And since we're at Masco, I have a much nicer desk than I and chair than I normally would have to sign a bill. So, congratulations. Right. Good work.
Thanks.
Thanks. Thanks. Thank you, Kevin. Thank you for being here. Thank you. Can I grab hold, Gail?
Yes.
Get a picture. Great. Well, thank you very much. This is exciting, and we appreciate everyone's efforts to do this. And I think we're going to do some more pictures with get our veterans up here.
Gentlemen, we now will take a break while they're doing group photos. It's an opportunity for you to go out, grab some coffee, maybe some little snack. Please be back here seated for the next panel presentation that starts promptly at 9:50. Thank you.
My name is Staff Sergeant Frank Peterson. I'm an unmanned aircraft systems operator. I'm Army strong, and I've got skills. UAS is unmanned aircraft system. It is an unmanned aircraft, which means we fly it basically remotely from the ground. We set it in a control station where we can see all the instrumentation off the aircraft and what we're looking at with the payload in order to put the aircraft where it needs to be and capture the data on the ground that we need to look at. There's quite a bit of skill involved in what we do. You have to have a situational awareness, the ability to multitask. There's a lot of information that an operator has to know in order to effectively do his job.
My name is Damien Doucette. I'm a SkyCam operator.
My name is Cody Taylor. I'm a SkyCam pilot,
and I've got skills.
We got 4-1. Watch us sneak.
It allows you a perspective that you just can't get from any of the other cameras.
Intercepted. Stay with them. Stay with them. You have to be able to handle a lot of pressure working on live television.
How you doing?
Staff Sergeant Peterson.
Damien.
This is Cody.
Cody Taylor. Pleased to meet you.
Yes, sir.
Welcome to our office.
We met Staff Sergeant Peterson here and did just a walkthrough of all of our equipment.
All right, Staff Sergeant. This is our number one real location. We showed him a tower, showed him how we rig the pulleys, how we get them up in the towers, how we get our lines and cables up. He was right there with me every step of the way.
You're basically setting your sight up, the whole thing, right?
Yeah.
We do the same kind of thing with we roll into an airfield. We have to occupy, you know, do some site survey stuff, set some equipment up. All the equipment has to be in place. So it's kind of the same thing.
So here we are, SkyCam control room. This is where we operate the system from.
One of you guys driving it, and one of you guys moving the pilot, the camera around kind of
thing. And I'm the gunner.
Got it.
You're here, and you're here, and you're here, and you have to also have to have a global concept of what's going on out there, the reels, how the whole rig's behaving.
We had the opportunity to put him on our joysticks, which is something I was really looking forward to.
Let's go plus X. It's very interesting, actually, in the parallels that we were able to share, especially up at our operating location. We have very similar functions in our jobs. There we go. We're flying.
When there's lives on the line, not that we don't take our stuff seriously, but he's operating on a whole different level, so I would think this would be a walk in the park for him.
Operating their equipment was kind of fun. There was a lot of education on my part as far as what goes into what these guys do and how this whole football process is videotaped. It's a lot to it. So kind of look forward to getting those guys out to Fort Huachuca so we can educate them on what a UAS operator actually does.
Hey,
Sergeant.
Good morning, guys. Good to see you again.
See you, Sergeant. How are you?
Good. Welcome to Bravo Company UASTB. I'm glad y'all are here and now y'all can see what we do as UAS operators. So you'll come in the hangar and I'll show you the aircraft real quick. Then we'll take you down to the flight line and show you how we fly.
Let's do it.
Guys, this is the Shadow. Brought him in the hangar, showed him the aircraft, showed him the Shadow, showed him the Hunter, just some basic information so they had an idea of what the aircraft even looked like. Took him out to the flight line and started showing them the processes that we go through to get an aircraft ready to fly.
We went out and looked at all the equipment associated with it, as far as the hardware that they used to actually control the aircraft when it's on the mission, and the retrieval gear that they use to grab it once it lands. So after the aircraft was launched, we were able to kind of go into the control room, which really was, I think, the part that we were looking forward to, because, you know, as we like to say, that's where the magic happens.
Do a selectable parameter button.
They do have rules here. They are a little more serious than we are, so we weren't able to get our hands on the actual piloting end of things. But he put us in the right seat, which is the payload operator.
Unmanned aircraft systems operator speak. Payload means we're referring to the camera on the aircraft.
A little different feel than what you're used to.
You bet. I like this input device, though. This stick is nice.
I was really impressed sitting down at their operator console.
Learn to do it kind of thing.
The pilot has the same types of monitors that I have. Again, we have the Play School version of what they've got here.
Go ahead and zoom in right there.
Gave them a couple of targets to go find and look at, so I kind of give them a little challenge. I'm willing to bet with some time and with a proper person behind them and teach them how to do it, they would get it pretty quick. I think it was a good experience for them to come see what we do in the Army as operators for unmanned aircraft. And same thing for us. I think it was a really good experience for me to go see what these guys do, because I had no idea that much work and effort and energy went into filming a football game to broadcast on TV. I had no idea.
You know, we have that saying, it's only TV. At the end of the day, there's a lot of pressure involved in what we do. But really, you got to kind of keep it in perspective. And what these guys do is the real deal.
It's very gratifying as a UAS operator to be in the field where you have that ground guy that comes back and says, hey, I'm glad you told me what you did today because I think you saved my life. Words can't describe the way that you would feel about that.
My name is Staff Sergeant Chris Alcorn. I am a motor sergeant at Fort Benning, Georgia. I am Army strong, and I've got skills. One of the vehicles I work on is the Bradley. The Bradley carries the infantry into the battle, and then it's able to sustain itself in the fight. You get into a sandy condition like Iraq, it's going to tear up the vehicles more. So my guys, you know, they have to pay special attention to certain pieces of that vehicle to ensure that it's operating properly.
My name is Mike Green, and I'm the crew chief of Tony Schumacher's NHRA Top Fuel Dragster, and I've got skills. Top Fuel Dragster is a rear motor dragster. The motor is behind the driver. It's basically built for one thing, accelerate as fast as it possibly can. I manage the team, make all the decisions from run to run on what changes we'll make to try to run as quick and fast as we possibly can. How you doing? Mike Green.
Sergeant Alcorn.
We're going to take a little time today and give you a little tour of our race shop here.
Sounds good.
All right, let's do it. This is the U.S. Army Top Fuel Dragster. Tony Schumacher drives it.
It was impressive to see the inner workings of the car. I've never seen the car with the body off of it.
But the only team that builds their own Top Fuel Dragsters.
Really?
And there's a lot of technology that the Army uses that we use. We've been developing a driver's capsule to try to build on our car to protect Tony in case of an accident. We went into our race trailer, you know, where we do our racks, where we do our rods and pistons. We went into our clutch area. This is a lounge where after we make a run, we'll download the data we're bringing in here and put it on this computer here.
Really amazing, just the different components and how they can test what the car does while it's running. So how many times a day do you guys rebuild the engines?
It just depends. Like on race day, we'll make 4 runs. So we'll rebuild it 3 times.
The way we operate and the way they operate is 2 totally different ways. Our setup, vehicle breaks down, we'll replace that engine because it's quicker. It gets that vehicle back out onto the battlefield.
I'll show you our rear tires. They're kind of interesting.
You're looking at tires that are probably 10 times the size of the tires that's on a regular pickup truck.
It winds up and gives us that
ideal traction for leaving the starting line.
I appreciate you having me out here, and I would really appreciate if you guys would come down to Fort Benning and let me show you how we do things down there.
I knew I was going to go to a maintenance facility, but I didn't realize that I was going to one this nice. This is a brand new facility. It's only been open a couple weeks, and it rivals our race car shop.
Let me show you the inside of the Bradley here.
All right, great. How many people ride in here?
This can hold 9 occupants in the back, and as you've got one driver, a TC, and a gunner.
They pack them in there and they go racing across the desert to protect our freedom.
It raises the gun tube up and down.
Sergeant Alcorn explained the controls, and when they actually lock onto a target, the Bradley can be going backwards, forwards, sideways, it doesn't really matter. They can fire and still hit that target.
What we got here is the 903 turbo engine and transmission that goes into the Bradley. This is roughly about 600 horsepower.
The engine systems and transmission systems that make them go as fast as they go, it's really impressive.
But we can hook it back up to the track itself and run the engine while it's sitting here and be able to diagnose it and see what's wrong with it.
Oh, yeah, right.
I'm Mike, I'd like to meet Chief Grover.
Chief Sir, Grover, how are you? Mike Curtis Green. Grover.
Chief Grover is the one who is in charge of this facility here.
Well, Mike, it wouldn't be fair to bring you here and only let you see the Bradley here without showing you the M1. The difference is this is 70 tons, that's 30 tons.
And what's the top speed of these?
65 miles an hour.
That's a lot of weight going that fast.
This is the engine for the M1. Absolutely one of the most amazing pieces of equipment I've ever seen. And I have 17 of these, so if I have one go down, I can just drop another one in and be right back in the fight in 2 hours.
Oh, that's amazing.
It was gratifying for me to be able to show him around and kind of give him an idea just, you know, what it is that we do.
Their jobs are designed to do one thing, do it well, it has to be right, and that's how we run a race team. So I think somebody that was trained in this environment would go into the civilian environment and have great success.
The pride they have in the race cars, you know, it's no wonder Tony Schumacher wins so much. These guys are doing stuff that no other team is able to do. And you know, and that's basically the Army is doing things that no other Army is able to do.
And to kick things off, I'm going to turn the mic over to Representative Gail Haynes, who was the sponsor of one of these great bills.
Thank you very much, Governor Snyder, for having me here today. And thank you to all of the veterans for your service and also to today's sponsors for making this possible. The legislation that is being signed today will allow a military healthcare specialist to use the education and experience that he or she obtained through military service toward a civilian emergency medical technician license. This is one of the many bills that my colleagues and I have been working on to make sure that veterans are fully recognized for their service to our country. Upon return, veterans should not have to repeat education to qualify for jobs that they have already been highly trained for. We will continue here in Michigan to break down employment barriers and assure that these talented individuals are welcome in Michigan. And our goal is to make Michigan the veteran-friendly state. So again, thank you, Governor, for your support. And thank you again to the military men and women who are here with us today. And at this point, I'd like to introduce my colleague, State Representative George Durrani.
Thank you. Thank you, Gail. It's an absolute honor for me to be here today with the governor today to sign this legislation into law. I was pleased to sponsor House Bill number 4754, which allows veterans to use their military experience in heating, cooling, and refrigeration when furthering their careers after service. But today is a little bit more personal for me. You see, today is my first bill signed into law. So, Thank you. And I'm also the son of an Army veteran who served during World War II. Now, I never took the opportunity to thank my dad for his service and his sacrifice. He's been gone for years, but I know he's with me today as I hold his good conduct medal in my hand. So I thank him with this bill, and I know he would be proud that my first law will help veterans. He is proud also today that we are sending a clear message that the people of Michigan are truly grateful for their service. And I'm pleased to have an outstanding veteran with me here today. As a U.S. Army veteran, Gary Tanner works tirelessly to help provide the best possible care for Michigan veterans and their families. His dedication has certainly improved the quality of life for veterans across the state. Thank you, Gary. So it's been an honor today to be a part of the celebration of signing of these bills, bills that will help support the brave men and women of our state. So I thank you, and I thank you, Governor, for the opportunity to thank my dad.
Thank you, George. Good morning, everyone. How's everybody doing today? My name is Bob Kozlowski, and it is my honor to be here today. You know, similar to George, my family has a deep history in the military. In fact, my grandfather was killed in World War II on a ship. So this really means a lot to me. I would like to thank several people. First off, I'd like to thank the Boilermakers 1609, the local, for helping me research a lot of this bill. You know, and I also like to thank the governor. I think the governor's vision for this is awesome. He's always on the forefront of working with veterans, and I applaud him for that. You know, our committee, we're all on the Military and Veteran Committee. Jim Stamos is our chair. I can tell you, when there's a red light and a green light how we vote, it is always a green light for veterans, and I applaud that. You know, I like to quote the 26th President of the United States, who argue that no other group of citizens deserve greater honor, respect, and gratitude than the nation's veterans. President Theodore Roosevelt once said, "A man who's good enough to shed his blood for his country is good enough to be given a square deal afterwards." You know, I like to take that one step further. I think it should be more than a square deal, and I think with the governor's lead, we're on our way. Thank you, and God bless.
Well, thank you for those wonderful talents. Let's sign the bill. Thank you.
I'll want to stand behind you.
And since we're at Masco, I have a much nicer desk than I and chair than I normally would have to sign a bill. So. Congratulations. Right. Good work.
Thanks.
Thank you, Governor. George, thank you for being here. Thank you. Can I grab hold, Gail?
Yes.
Get a picture. Great. Well, thank you very much. This is exciting, and we appreciate everyone's efforts to do this. And I think we're going to do some more pictures with get our veterans up here.
I'm Captain Justin Miller. I'm an information management officer in the United States Army.
I'm Chris Herbert, an engineer and founder of Phone Halo.
Welcome to I've Got Skills. I was in college, September 11th happened, and I guess in a sense felt a calling. My first 4 years in the military I spent as a paratrooper. I was with the 173rd Airborne and did two deployments with them. I'm responsible for server management, server configuration, ensuring the network is secure, and we're keeping people out that don't need to be on the network. This unit is, I would say, the premier signal battalion in the United States Army. We can deploy in counterinsurgency operations across the world. We can deploy in homeland defense missions. What I do is important because we are out there testing the newest communications equipment for the United States Army and determining how the Army will communicate for generations to come.
I'm Chris Herbert. I'm a founder of Phone Halo. We make software that helps you keep track of your stuff.
I was always into computers growing up, and I went into UC Santa Barbara as an electrical engineer. I was just thinking about maybe start a business, what would we do? And I lose and misplace things all the time. All my friends did, and we're like, that's it. That's the problem we all have. We all lose and misplace things. Every day brings a new challenge. Whether it's an engineering challenge, something with the product goes wrong that we need to fix and jump on. And when you can come in and provide solutions, that's a great feeling.
Welcome to Fort Bliss.
Great to be here.
I'm Justin.
I'm Chris. Nice to meet you.
Good to meet you. This is the home of the 86th Signal Battalion. This is where all of our day-to-day activities take place.
When I first showed up at the base, I really expected a lot smaller, more rugged base. This is like a city.
So this is what we affectionately refer to as Skynet.
While I was at Fort Bliss, I got to see a lot of really cool equipment.
These right here are server stacks. They make sure that only authorized users are validated and authenticated into the network.
Would these servers be deployed into the field?
Or sure,
are these,
I mean,
remote?
These things are incredibly portable.
Also amazing where you can take one of those server boxes and deploy it anywhere around the world and have internet in the most remote places.
When we get on ground, it's plug and play, they're ready to go.
In a few hours, you can have an entire team set up with the network anywhere in the world.
So this is a satellite transport terminal, or STT. We can take this in the middle of nowhere in Afghanistan, set it up, and pull a signal, and it's gonna provide data and voice communications for our warfighters.
So it's communicating with a satellite? Or?
It is.
Being able to interact with equipment that would cost millions of dollars. Use that on a daily basis, I think, is something that you would never get in the civilian world.
This is a normal laptop.
It's more ruggedized.
Army use. From the middle of Afghanistan, you can access consumer internet, like search engines, social networks, everything.
Yeah, all that and more.
Hi, Captain. Good to see you again.
Good to see you.
Phone Halo makes an app that helps you keep track of your stuff.
We were founded in 2009. We've grown steadily to around 9 employees total.
What I expected when I came out here to meet Chris was, Silicon Valley, VIP passes to the clubs in Hollywood. In fact, these were a bunch of just regular people and saw a lot of similarities in what I do and what they do. So Chris, how is this device gonna help me find my luggage?
So I showed Captain Miller a lot of the products that we're working on. We showed him new technology that we're gonna be releasing soon called Bluetooth Low Energy.
So now that it's in here, I'm gonna stash this bag and I'm not gonna tell you where it's at.
Go for it.
All right. The prime thing you learn in any engineering discipline is how to solve problems. I see him definitely applying that in what he's doing. You have to. And I can use that same methodology to solve problems in my own line of work as well. There it is. Amazing. I think it's a really neat product. I sort of hope Chris, slips me one before I get out of here.
I think that once you serve in the military and go out into the civilian world, I think you have a lot of the team building skills that a lot of people just don't have.
I definitely think my background with the United States Army and as a signal officer has prepared me more than enough for something like this. The skills that I've gotten, they translate over the leadership, the problem solving, taking care of your team, all that is going to come through and help me succeed.
I think Captain Miller would definitely fit in. I'd hire him.
To learn more about my job as an information management officer, go to the career page at GoArmy.com.
My name is Major Nichelle Johnson, and I am an Army dietitian at Fort Knox. I am Army strong, and I've got skills. As an Army dietitian, I see patients. Then outside of that, they kind of use me as a nutrition liaison between MedCom and Fort Knox, making sure that they're following the goals of where nutrition care needs to go.
I'm Jerome Brown. I'm a personal chef to athletes and entertainers, and I've got skills. When you're a personal chef, people are trusting you that what you say is going to work for their body. They're not going to feel like they're on a diet. They're going to feel like they're getting the same quality that they're getting if they go to the finest restaurant. I got my start in the U.S. Army. The Army gave me an opportunity to take it to another level.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi, how are you? Major Johnson. I'm good. How are
I'm
you?
I'm Chef Rome.
Nice to meet
you. So you're joining me today, huh?
I am. I'm in your world.
All right. Well, we're going to prepare a couple things for my client, Josh Powell.
Okay, awesome.
So we're going to start with the meats and seafood.
Okay.
All right, great place to start. Let's go.
Okay.
Josh is a power forward for the Atlanta Hawks. Based on his lifestyle, I wanted to do a fish and I wanted to do a lean protein. So I saw a really nice black grouper steak.
I think that's a great choice. In addition to the omega-3s that it offers, it also is able to decrease, you know, your risk for cardiovascular disease.
As a dietitian, I'm always looking for ways to improve the taste of food without messing up the nutritional value of it.
I found her to be very knowledgeable. When you've been doing it as long as I have and you can still learn from someone, that's a good thing. Now we'll head on down to the produce department.
I'm loving it. I'm seeing the vitamin A, I'm seeing the citrus, the vitamin C. This is awesome. But I like the fact of how you start with your proteins, making sure that, you know, they're getting things for the muscles, and then you kind of warp into the vegetables and the seasonings, and you're still keeping health number one.
Come on in.
So, Michelle, we want you to meet Josh Powell. Josh,
hi, how are you?
Michelle. Today we're going to do a black grouper for you, Asian style, and then we're going to do an Italian veal chop for you.
One of the things that I think Chef Rome may have gained while he was in the Army as a cook is the preparation techniques, having to, you know, start really, really early to get everything done and everything done at one time.
All we want to do is extract the flavors out of here. We'll add some of that.
Everything kind of went together with why he was choosing it, trying to find the greatest nutritional value, as well as making sure that he pleased the client. We've set up a time for Chef Rome to come to Fort Knox. He'll be able to see what has changed from when he was in the Army to what the Army is now.
Hello.
Chef Rome, how are you?
I'm good,
amazing. Welcome, welcome.
Thank you.
I have the hat for you, because you're now in my world.
All right.
All right, so you welcome to Ireland Army Community Hospital. I'm going to show you some of the things that, you know, I do while I'm here. We'll go ahead and get started.
All right, let's go.
All right. The type of clientele that come to the hospital, we're talking about beneficiaries, we're talking about active duty, we're talking about their family members or retirees coming in because they have diabetes or coming in because they have high cholesterol. Those are the same things that I see patients for. This is one of the things that I do throughout the course of the day. I will counsel soldiers. Okay. Specialist Brown is here today. He's been referred to us because he has hypertension.
What are you eating, soldier?
Lovely fast food, of course, which I know is not very good for you, but hey, when you're in a hurry, when a soldier on the go, sometimes that's what easy habit to pick up.
So do you read the food labels at all?
I don't read them that much.
Particularly if you have hypertension, you know, one of the things you want to be mindful of is your salt intake.
It was good to hear Chef Rome talk about those things because I know that, you know, with him being able to contribute to the conversation meant that these are things that he looks at too as a chef.
After that, we went over to DFAT, or dining facility. And so in my mind, I already had this preconceived notion about what it was gonna be like. Walked in the door, the place looked like a new nickel. Shiny, fresh out the box, equipment. Just like, wow, this is just totally different from what it used to be like.
In all dining facilities, they're all gonna start adhering to certain ways of preparing food, being more consistent with the types of recipes that we use, making sure everyone's using the same ones. Wow. Making sure that, you know, what we're preparing is as healthy as possible.
The Army is going in a direction where they want the soldier to be healthier, and she's definitely doing all she can to get that information out there.
Okay.
A lot of the things that Major Johnson spoke of today served as a reminder that I can continue to implement to do an overall great job for the athletes and entertainers that I cook for.
When I was in his world, you know, he was having an awesome time, you know, being in the kitchen preparing the meals. You know, just as him coming here, I hope he saw that how happy I am to be an Army dietitian and not only affect the soldiers and what they eat, but also being able to affect them just as individuals.
I'm Warrant Officer Sam Lovell, UH-60 Black Hawk pilot in the United States Army.
I'm Sherry Avery,
I'm the air traffic control district manager for the Los Angeles area.
Welcome to I've Got Skills. My career is in aviation, obviously. I'm a UH-60 Black Hawk pilot. And the branch I work in is to support the ground command. We are here as a support element. Flying to me, first of all, means everything. It's how I make my living.
I'm the actual tower manager at LAX, and I oversee the managers of 8 other airports. LAX is the big boy. 1,850 operations a day, that's takeoffs and landings. LAX is the third busiest airport in the United States.
Good morning, I'm Warrant Officer Sam Lovell. Welcome to Fort Bliss.
Sherry Avery.
Come on, hi. Sherry, let me show you around. This is the Combat Aviation Brigade, and here you can see we have 40 to 50 Apache helicopters, 40 to 50 Black Hawk helicopters, about 15 Chinooks, and around 15 Medevac helicopters. Sherry, this is the UH-60 Black Hawk helicopter. This is what I fly, and it is a utility helicopter.
It's so organized. All those helicopters, all those different kinds, the maintenance going on.
Justice Farmer is one of our crew chiefs.
I liked the way people treated each other. A true caring about each other, a team where they back each other up.
In that emergency, Specialist Farmer knows from memory or he has a checklist to tell us what to do.
They really function effectively.
You will never see an Army helicopter fly without two pilots at all
times. So that's your backup.
The aircraft has more available, such as more than one engine. It has more than one radio. It has multiple ways that I can carry equipment, and I can carry more than one thing, and I'm responsible for all that.
Using checklists, all four of them crawling all over it, there's a lot of nurturing, there's a lot of mentoring. They are setting themselves up for all kinds of careers in the civilian world with really specific skills.
So there's a lot going on up here, whereas a civilian pilot may have one or two tasks, we have a lot more going on at the same time.
Oh, he's a multitasker. His attention to detail is great, his professionalism.
I have received an instrument ticket, I received a multi-engine aircraft rating and a helicopter rating, and it's all transferable to the outside. So it makes me a better candidate for those jobs on the outside.
Airlines can land in no visibility, nothing, zero, zero. So it's same handbook, the same phraseology, the same procedures as we do in our tower.
M24, your sister ship.
Sherry, this is our tower. First here you have our flight line. If you look off in the distance, you can see all the helicopters parked, and this is where they would take off from. And as a helicopter pilot myself, my relation with ATC begins here.
I mean, you are our bread and butter. If nobody's flying, you don't need controllers.
Absolutely.
And we're all in the safety business, really the same mission.
So you think being a helicopter pilot, if I ever decide to be ATC, is going to help me?
Oh, yeah. You're going to be more patient on the air. There's going to be a yelling at pilots or showing any kind of impatience at all, because you're going to know they need time to do all the things they need to do to get ready to land.
Absolutely.
Well, Sam, now that you've shown me all about aviation at Fort Bliss, let me show you my world, aviation at LAX.
Let's go. Hey, Sherry.
When I took Sam up in the tower today, I was excited because he was interested in the equipment, and I said, oh, have I got equipment to show you? And I got to show him something called ASDX, which is our ground radar, because he was wondering, how do you keep track of who all these airplanes are taxiing around?
I think it was a real experience as a pilot to see that. You know, it really opens your eyes to the world of aviation. A lot of responsibility falls on Miss Avery's shoulders. It's amazing. If I do have the opportunity, once I'm all finished with the Army and I get out, I would like to say it would make me a little more appealing to an employer.
And we're just outside of taxiway Delta 7, south of runway 24 left. How do you like the view from here?
It's pretty familiar, but the vehicles are a bit bigger than the ones I'm used to.
It's a big orchestrated, choreographed operation, just like yours. I think that watching Sam for an entire day at Fort Bliss made me want to steal him and bring him back as a controller at LAX.
Being a soldier is probably one of the proudest moments I've ever experienced, and just having instilled inside of me those core values that the Army wants you to have. Being a soldier is everything. I felt a sense that I wanted to go do something spectacular, and I did. To learn more about my job as a Black Hawk pilot, go to the careers page on GoArmy.com.